Okay, so I don't know if this is working. Hopefully people can hear me back. I'll be loud anyway. So, hi, I'm going to talk about transaction malleability in Bitcoin, threats and solutions. So, quick overhead intro. I'm working on Bitcoin cryptocurrency stuff. I think it's really exciting. I know that there's going to be a wide range of knowledge and interest among the people in the audience. Some people will understand all of this and be a little bored. Some people have no idea what's going on. That's okay. You can ask questions. This will be a technical deep dive and hate-o-pelagic, and so definitely ask questions. And if the question is such that it would probably take too long to explain and disrupt the whole thing, we can ask, you know, I can talk to you after.
A natural question.
Yeah. Hate-o-pelagic is the deepest zone of the ocean. So it's a deep dive. yeah, so ask questions, and at worst I'll be like, ask me after, and we can talk after. Okay, so the basic gist, I'm going through like what I'll talk about in the talk. Malleability, what is it? What it is not. I'll talk about transactions, TXIDs, and addresses. How to change the TXID. Go over BIP62 a little bit. I'll talk about third-party and second-party attack models. An example attack, and some workarounds. No TXIDs, and normalized TXID hashes. So this might sound a little weird, but it'll all make sense in the end. Okay, so what is malleability? And as we know, Bitcoin's modeled after gold, which is the most malleable metal. Yeah, it can be compressed into a very thin sheet. So it's only appropriate that Bitcoins are also malleable. Right, so I'm just kidding. Malleability is when a transaction changes after you sign it, which seems like that shouldn't happen, right? If you write a check and you sign it and then someone changes it afterwards, that's bad, right? But that happens in Bitcoin. Okay, so what malleability isn't, so what sort of brought malleability to the forefront of many people's minds is a certain exchange fell apart a little over a year, or less than a year ago, and they blamed malleability publicly. However, this is really not the case. There's a great paper by these two guys, I don't know what university they're at, that documented, have it open, yeah, Bitcoin transaction malleability in Mt. Gox, and they have a really nice paper like analyzing the entire blockchain, everything that went on, and it's clear that malleability had nothing to do with Mt. Gox's problems. And it's really nice. So don't ask questions about Gox, just ask, read this paper, and you'll be like, okay, it wasn't malleability. Malleability has been known about for years and sort of isn't a big deal, or is it? It seems like people cannot steal your Bitcoins based on malleability. But later I'll show you how they actually kind of can, if you're doing interesting things. Okay. So first, I'll just go over really quick what a transaction is. Lots of people have looked at like blockchain.info, which I didn't actually want to screenshot because I'm not too cool with how they've been dealing with things lately. So I took, you know, insight into that. You usually look at it as address sends to address, right? That's the mental model most of us have for Bitcoin, is that I've got my address, it starts with one, has a bunch of random letters and numbers, and there's 2.5 Bitcoins in this address, and I send them all to this other address, my friend. And then it gets confirmed, and then there's a little fee, which is the difference between these two numbers, and it gets confirmed January 4th or whatever. And then there's this TXID, which I don't know what that is. Usually I don't deal with those, because I'm just moving Bitcoins around. But this is not actually how Bitcoin works. And if we open up this, you know, if you click an insight on the TXID, you get this other stuff, which is a bunch of random numbers. It still says, okay, here's one address sending to another address. Okay, so I like WebBTC. It's a nice block explorer that gives a lot more detailed information. And when you click on a transaction in WebBTC, you get this, which still has from address and to address, but it's got this other stuff, right? Previous output, some hex, last one, value, next input, value, to address. So this is a little more involved. And actually, I think I clicked on hex and got the hex of this transaction and then put it directly into Bitcoin D. And I got this. You can't go to the top. But anyway, you say Bitcoin CLI, decode raw transaction, just dump hex. and it will give you a nice JSON of the transaction. The transaction itself is this whole thing. It's just a big block of heck, you know. They're usually like 200, 300, 400 bytes, depending on how many inputs and outputs. And this is a transaction. So I'll go real quick. You'll notice there's two main sections. There's the VIN section and the VOutput section. So VIN is your inputs, where you're spending from. VOut is your outputs, where you're spending to. And in this case, I made a simple one where there's only one input and one output, right? Same as, you know, it's this one. So the things that you'll see is kind of, there is an address in the output, right? I changed it because I'm using testnet Bitcoin CLI, so it made it a testnet address instead of a regular. But you've got this script, opdo bosh hash 160, this hash, and then equal verify checksig. You also specify the value for your output, but not for your input. And you actually don't specify an address for your input. For your input, you just say, here's the TXID, here's the index, and here's my signature. And there's no sequence at runtime, but I don't talk about that. And then this TXID is for the entire transaction. So basically, you're spending from a TXID to an address. And this entire transaction's TXID goes at the top. So basically, yeah, you spend to an output script. In most cases, it looks like this, where this 0177 part is the 20-byte hash of your pub key, and this has a one-to-one correspondence to an address. So if you give me an address, I can give you this 20-byte hex, and vice versa. That's what 99.9% of Bitcoin transactions look like with the output. The input, however, you don't specify an address that you're spending from. You specify a TXID, and yeah, this is a little confusing because like the V out here corresponds to the N here. I don't know why these things are written that way, but that's just the index. So if you have like multiple inputs or outputs, you start with 0, then go to 1, 2. So like this, in this case, the V out of 1 means it was the, you know, N of 1, or the second output of that thing. So the TXID comes from the SHA-256 of the whole transaction. And you don't know the TXID until after the transaction is signed, because the signature is part of the transaction. So basically, if I took this whole hex of the transaction and fed it into SHA-256 sum, I would get this. So you don't know your TXID until after you've signed it. Right? You've signed it, you've created the whole thing, you send it to an output, now I know my TXID. So addresses, transaction inputs are TXIDs and VOUTs. Outputs are addresses or scripts. And a TXID is not the same as an address. The inputs and outputs are totally different things. That's weird, but it's okay, right? The transaction output address can't change because you signed it. But you didn't sign your TXID because that would be non-causal, right? You don't know it until after you sign. So your TXID can change. So I'll just go back here. When you're creating a transaction, you say, okay, my Bitcoins are in this old transaction, the other one. I'm gonna sign it, but when I sign here, I'm gonna include this in my signature, where I'm sending it to. So I say, okay, I wanna send it to this guy, MCCK. This is my friend that I'm buying chocolate chip cookies from. I specify his address, and I sign it, specifying my input. But I don't know this TXID until after I've done signing. Okay, so your TXID can change. How can it change? You can change the signature itself. You can invert the S value, which is part of the ECDSA process. You just multiply by -1, essentially. You make a negative version of that S value. It's still valid. Anyone can do that. Anyone can grab your signature and basically flip it. At this point, it's not even non-standard. I think every node will relay this and include it in a block and everything. You can also push useless stuff onto the stack, like a number, then drop it. This is non-standard and won't be relayed, but it won't. It's not prohibited. So if a miner does that, it'll be accepted as a block. So basically, any change of even one bit anywhere in your transaction will completely change the TXID. That's how SHA-256 works. And miners can do it really easily. And well-connected nodes may also be able to do it with some probability, right? If I see your transaction, grab it, change the S value, and then rebroadcast it, I have a chance that my transaction that I changed will be seen by everyone else first, if I'm better connected. And they both look the same. They have a different TXID, but they have the same inputs and the same output. So no one knows that one's wrong or malleated or anything. Okay, so there's a proposal, BIP62, and it wants to restrict the transaction validity, prevent malleability. So they've identified a whole bunch of sources of the problem, such as the S value being negative. Okay, let's ban negative S values, it has to be positive. Pushing stuff onto the stack, so only data, perhaps, can be pushed onto the stack. This seems to be able to solve third-party malleability, where you're sending, you know, Alice sends to Bob, but then Carol grabs the transaction and changes it. This seems to be able to solve it, but the signing party can always change the TXID, and I'll go into that in a second. But that's okay, right? So we'll back up for a second. Wait, who cares? Why exactly is this even a problem? What happens if the TXID changes? What exactly is the threat we're looking at? So I'll talk about three things. There's an A to B transfer, unconfirmed change spends, and signing transactions that haven't happened yet. Okay, so the first is an A to B transfer. Alice sends Bitcoin to Bob. She sends from TXID, A3, blah, 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 to address 1ZMOL. She creates a transaction, her TXID is BD0354, but then wait, someone changed it. The TXID that gets into the block, verified, has 66B230. And so Alice is panicking, and she calls up Bob. She's like, hey, Bob, the TXID changed. Bob's sort of like, yeah, what do I do? The new TXID is 66B26EB0. And Bob's like, OK, yeah, that's what I saw. And Alice says, well, the one I created and signed was BD0354. And Bob's just waiting, and he's like, what's the problem? Bob got his Bitcoins. Alice's transaction went through. This is really not a problem for Bob. Bob sees the new TXID. Bob probably never saw the old one. And he gets his Bitcoin, he can spend it. So in this scenario, it really doesn't matter. And this has been happening for a couple years. Random hackers might be able to change your TXID, but you still get the Bitcoins. You just get a different TXID than the guy sent, but who cares? You just sign the new one if you want to spend it. One potential issue is unconfirmed change. So Alice sends Bitcoin to Bob and one back to herself. This is very common in Bitcoins. You're going to see a lot of, you know, one input, two outputs. So one Bitcoin to Bob's address and one to Alice's address. She then immediately sends that one Bitcoin to Carol, right? This output to herself, she sends to Carol before it's confirmed. This can be an issue because she sends from a TXID that's not in the block yet, and that TXID could change. So her transaction 1 TXID, BBE7, she's sending from here, right, output VOUT 1 of BBE7 to Carol. She may have to re-sign. She may think she sent it to Carol and then turns her computer off, and that signature is not valid because this TXID has changed. So her spend fails. She can go back later. You know, she goes back tomorrow when Carol calls her up and says, I never got the coin. So Alice can now resend. She still has it, but the send failed. So that is kind of a problem. And I think Bitcoin D either doesn't spend unconfirmed change or something. I don't know if that, I don't remember how it deals with it. But it's something of an issue. Okay, so the real issue, refunds. If you're doing fancy stuff that few people are doing right now. So things like a multi-sig payment channel, where you have an address X, which is a 2 of 2 multi-sig address. So Alice and Bob both need to sign to spend from address X. So now before Alice sends to address X, Bob signs his half of a refund transaction. However, if the TXID changes, that refund is no longer valid, and Bob can always re-sign the refund. But it's an issue, right? So here I have a refund happens before the fund transaction, right? Alice wants to know that if I'm putting my Bitcoin in this shared address, that I can get it out. The worst thing that, you know, worst comes to worst, and Bob disappears. Well, I still have his potentially time-locked his signature for a time-locked transaction that'll refund my Bitcoins. So my fund transaction has TXID BFE1, and here's Alice's old output, you know, old address, sending it to 3 Alice and Bob. And 3 means it's multi-sig, basically. However, okay, what if this changes, right? Here's my funds transaction ID, BFE1. Someone changed it to 3AA1. Now, this is no longer valid. My refund is referencing a TX ID that doesn't exist. Okay, so this is a problem because Bob can say, "Geez, looks like the TX ID changed." I know, malleability, they resigned the refund with the new TX ID of 3A11. And no, so Alice is asking Bob, "Hey, resign." And Bob says, "Gee, Alice, you know, things are really tough right now. How about a refund where I get half the coin?" And Alice is like, "No way, I'm not going to sign that. Screw that." And Bob's like, "That's okay, I'll wait. Here you go." And Bob signs a new refund with the new TX ID, where Alice gets back half and evil Bob gets half. And there's no lock time, so Alice is able to do this whenever she wants. Bob can now just leave. Bob either gets half the coin for free or doesn't, but eventually Alice will cave, right? Unless these guys know each other and Alice can, like, you know, go beat up Bob. But this is a pretty big attack. If you break the TX ID of the refund, you know, of the multi-sig for the refund, the other party who has really no stake in the game can sort of dictate the whole hostage situation here. So that's a problem. But that's more of a third-party attack, right? Because Bob has to grab Alice's fund transaction, change it before it gets in a block. So if Alice is the only one signing, it's a third-party attack, right? Grab has to grab it, change the TXID. BIP62 may be able to help with this and lock down third-party malleability. But what if Alice and Bob both fund X? Check lock time verified also doesn't. This is something that would help in this case. Check lock time verified does not help when you have two people funding X and the refund going back to the two people. And there are reasons where you want this for payment channels and stuff, where you could have sort of a bi-directional payment channel, where both people put in a coin and they want to be able to send it back and forth. And check lock time verified can help where, in the case where it's all going to one person, but not when it's going to two people. Because you can't specify amounts in the script. So, second-party attacks are really a big problem, right? This is the case where you've got a fund transaction with two inputs, right? One COA, 998B, and the output goes to Alice and Bob's address. The refund also goes to Alice and Bob separately, and it's lock timed. Problem is, if you change this, this is no longer valid. And you can sort of hold the Bitcoin's hostage. And this is actually something you can't fix. BIP62 can lock down third-party malleability, but if an attacker...
How is this case different than the one we just went over?
This has two signatures for the fund transaction.
Oh, okay.
Right, I should specify that. Let's say this is Alice's and this is Bob's. So, they can re-sign. And, you know, one of the two is going to be able to re-sign. You both can in practice, but one can always re-sign. And this can't be fixed. And BIP62 acknowledges this. Like, ECDSA inherently is, I can re-sign with a different K, and it'll change the whole thing. So ECDSA uses an ephemeral key K for all signatures. You may have heard of this recently from, like, Blockchain Info's horrible mess of random number generation. K has to be a random, unique, and secret number. And it stays secret. You never know what K is unless you're the guy who generated it and signed with it. So there's a bunch of talk about, and there's an RFC that's, I don't think, even Bitcoin related. This was just a good idea of how to make a K, an ephemeral key, for ECDSA without needing random numbers. Essentially what it is like HMAC of private key and message. You basically hash your private key and message. The actual RFC has, like, a lot of weird stuff, which to me seems unnecessary, but maybe there's a reason for it. But basically what you do is you take your private key, you take your message that you want to sign, in this case the transaction, mix them together using a hash function, and use that as your K value. This is a really good idea, right? K values should be deterministic and standardized. I think a lot of software is using RFC 6979 now. The thing about it is, you should use it, but you can't tell if someone's using it, right? There's no way to verify that if you sign something using RFC6979, I don't know. I don't know what K-value you used, because I don't know your private key. In order to verify that, I know your message, but I don't know this, so I can't go through and verify that you adhere to this. So if I see two valid, identical ECDSA6, identical in that they have the same message that they're signing, and they have the same pub key, well, I know at most one of them is compliant, because this RFC means there's only one possible output, but you can always change it. So this is a good idea, everyone should do it, but I can't tell if you're doing it or not. So I can't, in a programmatic way, restrict people to using this. So one idea that was going around about a year ago is to fix this with a normalized hash, basically a TXID that doesn't reference the entire transaction, a TXID that cuts out the script sections. So for the normal TXID, you take the whole transaction, you know, the inputs and all of the, you know, the outputs, the whole thing. With a normalized hash, the input scripts, this part, are omitted. So this is where all the change happens. This is where someone can push weird stuff onto the stack. This is where they can re-sign with a new ECDSA signature. You just omit those. And the normalized hash will not change when the signatures or scripts change. You'd have to change the output, which would require people re-signing. And changing the output would change the whole thing, so it's okay. Normalized hashes are useful, but replacing TXIDs with normalized hashes is a hard fork, and it's not just a hard fork, it's basically impossible, because your entire blockchain would need to be rewritten, and your old transactions would have to be re-signed. It's a mess. It'd be great if we started this way, but we didn't. So maybe these can coexist. Maybe with a new sig hash bit that indicates normalized hashes instead of TXIDs. So there's four current different sig hash types in Bitcoin. So when you're signing a transaction, you can specify. Generally, it's always sig hash off, where you sign all the inputs of your transactions and all the outputs. You can do sig hash none, which is crazy, where you sign your inputs, but you don't sign your output. So anyone can just change the output of your transaction. I don't know of any actual use for this. It's basically, please take my money, but you can do it. It's a thing in there. There's sig hash single, which is also kind of weird, and I don't know if it's got any use. Does anyone know? Where you sign one input, where, like, let's say your input is like V out 0, and you also sign the output number 0. So, like, if you have a stack of all the different inputs and outputs, you sign like one row of them. I don't know any use of it right now. There's also sig hash anyone can pay, which signs one input and all outputs and allows for other inputs to be added on after the fact. This is actually kind of useful. And this is, so these are all mutually exclusive, I'm pretty sure, and this is a flag. So you can sort of, you know, pour these together. So if you had like a sig hash type that was like 8-1, or no, I don't remember, but I forget. But sig hash anyone can pay modifies the other one. So you can say like sig hash single and anyone can pay at the same time. So those are the current sig hash types. So one way that I'm proposing you can fix malleability is have malleable signatures. If you can't stop TXID malleability, work around it. So let's say you had sig hash, no TXID. You sign something, but your signature does not include the TXIDs of your inputs. Or you remove the inputs entirely. Once I looked at this, I was like, well, you don't really need to sign the script. You could just get rid of the inputs completely. You have a signature that signs any input that it fits with, which should probably only be one, and only signs the outputs. So you can have a sig hash no input, for example. Or, I think probably the best, is sig hash normalized TXID, where your signature, you replace the TXID of your input with a normalized transaction hash, and then sign. Then it's still highly specified. So basically, I'll try to explain how this would work. With a different sig hash type, the signatures don't have to change when the TXIDs change. So in the case where someone changes the fund transaction ID. Okay, so Bob changed it. Bob's a bad guy. He changed it here. I can now take my input that I'm referencing, and also change it without re-signing. So essentially Bob's signature, Bob's refund signature, is good for any TX item. I can change the input TXID without resigning. So malleability is okay. My outputs can be changed, but my inputs can also be changed the same way. Safety-wise, so something like sighash no TXID or sighash no input, they're actually kind of dangerous. Because what if you have two outputs to the same address? So for example, Alice has 5 bitcoins at her address, but there's 2 different transactions. One is a spend of 4 bitcoins to that address, and one is a spend of 1 bitcoin to that address. And if she wants to spend 1 bitcoin and send it somewhere else, the miner can easily change it with this new, you know, non-specified input to reference the 4 bitcoin one and grab the other 3. Right, the outputs stay the same, but since you change the input to the larger one, you can, as a miner, grab the rest. So the solution to this is don't reuse addresses. Normalized hash is safer. You can replace a TXID with a normalized hash for the signing process. You're still signing a specific transaction, you're just referencing it a different way. The normalized hash stuff was all implemented about a year ago. It never got merged into Bitcoin because it didn't. If you look at the long and kind of wordy thing, it was mostly about Mt. Gox. And they're like, this is not going to solve the Mt. Gox problem. But the code is actually really simple. It's like a couple lines. You can create it on the fly. So if you reference, you know, your transactions will still have regular TXIDs, but your signatures will reference a different one that you can calculate really quickly.
So
we
can do a fork of our own fork version.
Yeah. So this is a soft fork. This is a good segue. How could you get this change into Bitcoin? Hard forks are hard. Soft forks are things that further restrict transactions and don't really need 99% of nodes to switch at once. You just need a majority before you can use it. So one idea I call P3SH. P2SH worked really well to get a lot of fancy stuff into Bitcoin. And you can make P3SH, which is just the exact same thing, but you use op equal verify instead of op equal. And then you specify new sig hash types that are possible when using P3SH.
What's the difference between op equal and op equal?
In this case, nothing. op equal will return a 1 or a 0. Op equal verify will either return a 1 or essentially crash the whole thing and invalidate the entire transaction. Since it's at the end, it doesn't make any difference. This is just a completely cosmetic difference. So that, you know, because P2SH right now, if you have these opcodes, Bitcoin treats it special, right? It doesn't actually look for a pre-image of this. It looks for a script and then executes it. So you can do the same thing. This is just a slight variant where we can specify, okay, with this new variant, we have these new sighash types. P3SH can have the new sighash types. You could use any, all of them. I sort of think sighash norm TXID is probably the safest because normalized hashes are already implemented, tested, and address reuse stays safe with this. In conclusion, TXIDs will remain malleable. And for the real problem, where it really comes up as a problem, it's a second party attack, not a third party attack. And there's no way around that, right? Because Bob can always re-sign with a new K value. But if your signatures reference data, which is non-malleable, the problem's solved. Essentially, you can't solve output malleability, so you make your inputs equally malleable. This isn't really a feature request. It's kind of more of a bug fix, so maybe we can get it through. We talked to Gavin about it in December, and he sounded pretty cool with it. So this may be something to try to get through as a change in Bitcoin in the next year. Once you don't have to worry about malleability, there's all these really cool things you can do. Contract types and payment channel networks and all sorts of crazy stuff that people have been thinking about for a while and documented, but really break pretty hard because of malleability. So with this, I'm hoping there can be lots of new fun use cases for Bitcoin. If people have questions, we can go through stuff, but that's basically my proposal for a sighash norm TXID thing.
So yes. What are some of those use cases you're thinking about?
Payment channel networks. That's one of the big ones where, you know, there's the payment micro payment channels where you essentially you put stuff in a 202 address, and then I sign my half, giving some more to you, and you don't have to push it to the blockchain, because essentially my half of this, you know, my signature for that half of the transaction is as good as the spend itself, because you can at any time. There's a bunch of documentation about that, and you can also sort of make like a hub and spoke model for payment transactions, and like, it's really good for scalability. There's also some like contract stuff you can do, which I'm working on, with all sorts of fancy things.
Can you give us an example?
You can have financial derivatives. A lot of what Ethereum wants to do, you can sort of do in Bitcoin. Just saying, I mean, there's all these opcodes. There's like 100 something opcodes. And they're really powerful. And you can have like, you know, you need to be able to spend stuff that hasn't existed yet. So I know that if this transaction goes through, some other transactions go through, or like potential trees of transactions, stuff like that. So there's cool stuff you can do. I think the payment channel networks are probably the most widely known and you know, the most obvious problem that malleability really hits. So, yeah.
In your example for the normalized hash, how did you actually go back and change the transaction ID of the refi once you have discovered that the funding transaction?
Oh, I just rewrite, I mean, okay, well, so in the case of a normalized hash, this won't be able to change. In the case where you don't sign your input TX ID, your input TX ID, anyone can change it to anything. Since it's not part of your signature, it's completely malleable, where any third party can just change your input TX ID to anything, to reference any transaction. Most of them won't work because your signature is still there. It's going to try to stick your signature onto a completely inappropriate script, so it'll fail. So yeah, in the case of the normalized TX ID, this, your TX IDs may change, but the signature doesn't reference a TX ID. The signature references a normalized hash, which won't change depending on this. So yeah, this example is actually a SIGHNO TX ID example, where, okay, you change the output, I'll change my input to the exact same thing without having to resign. But yeah, with a normalized TX ID, it's a little different. It's you are not able to change this part, but you don't need to because it won't.
Is your question though kind of driving on the vein of, okay, if you are doing, you know, a refund transaction, just, you know, get an adequate number of confirmations on that and be sure,
or you can. The whole thing with the refund is like, the refund happens before the fund, which is a little like counterintuitive.
Well, yeah, but what I'm saying is like, make sure that refund transaction is malleated.
You can't, right? Because the refund doesn't exist. The refund, you have the refund transaction on your hard drive,
yeah.
But it's not in the blockchain. And if you try to push it to the blockchain, everyone will be like, there is no 87B. And you're like, oh yeah, I have to publish this first before this. So that's the problem. The refund signatures and stuff happen before the actual funding. So this is why malleability really breaks these things. You know, the whole idea is you want to be able to spend something that doesn't exist. Yeah,
If you're talking about doing a USB or whatever, do a soft fork for a different TX ID, have you thought much about just switching the signature type as well from like CDSA at CDSA to like Schnorr or something?
So Gavin was talking about Schnorr
signatures. For like canonical signatures.
Yeah. See, I think like for me, it's like modify as little as possible, because like really the normalized hash thing is like really like two lines of code, and then a couple lines in like the JSON plugin part, but it's like super simple, and so I'm like, this is the simplest possible,
so
safest possible way. What?
A Schnorr signature is trivial too.
Hey, if people, the thing is, it's like, if you're gonna do a soft fork and have P3SH anyway, yeah, you might as well do like a bunch of stuff, I guess. right? But so like, For me, it's like I'm just some random guy who thinks this is a cool thing we can fix with Bitcoin. So I'm trying to make it like the minimum possible. Yeah. Okay, it's like one bit difference in the Sigcash type, and it does like two extra lines of code or something. But yeah, it's, you know, there's gonna have to be changes pushed through, and so, you know, you might as well do a whole bunch at once. So maybe op-lock time verify happens in here as well.
Have you thought much about like what a particular, what applications that would enable on top of just to address the second party malleability attacks? How much would something like a deterministic CI?
The normalized hashes solve second party stuff, right? You can re-sign, but it won't change your normalized TXID. So, I'm pretty sure this, you know, normalized data hash will fix that. I mean, for the stuff, there may be other uses that it won't, with like, anyone can pay things, But I mean, for the stuff I was looking at, which is mostly like payment channels and things like that, this would fix it. But yeah, definitely, like, I don't know, I guess you just go on GitHub and start pushing stuff around and go on the IRC and be like, hey, I don't know how it works in terms of like getting consensus on what changes happen when. But yeah, it's definitely the kind of thing that if you're gonna change this, it's a software, you might as well put some other stuff in at the same time. So I would wanna work with people on like, you know, how to do that. But this actual is like very limited change. So you can tack it on with our stuff.
So you're saying you can play around with EPSH in our own.
Yeah, I mean, if you want new weird opcodes, so like put locked, I don't know what their idea for check lock time verify is, and how you would, I mean, that's also a software, because it's a new opcode. So you take one of the no ops or something. You can't really modify P2SH to have new sig hash types, so you'd have to have sort of a new thing. But if you're doing this, you can like put new opcodes and new other signature types and stuff like that in there along with it. So that's like a, you know, there's a whole bunch of stuff. And like then there's the hard fork that like, talking to Gavin, he's like, yeah, we need to make the block size bigger, which is hard fork. And if you're doing that, then I guess you don't even need this. You can just modify P2SH. I don't know. So yeah, how exactly it gets implemented is not something, I mean, on the one hand, it's trivial. It's like five lines of code. On the other hand, it's like, it's Bitcoin. So you got to get everyone to get on board. So that's the hard part. Any other questions about all this? If people have questions about like the actual application, so like for normal, if you just want to like buy like a computer on Newegg, this probably doesn't matter and affect you. Like malleability is not something to worry about, but the extensions, a lot of the stuff that people talk about, like the future of it, contracts and payment channels and all these micro payments and stuff, they do actually sort of break because of malleability. And you know, a lot of the Bitcoin 2.0 stuff can happen just with Bitcoin 0.9 as long as malleability is fixed. Yeah.
I'd love to know, along the lines of, if this was fixed or even on a software, how much of what Ethereum is trying to do in other platforms could be actually be done with Bitcoin with the software?
Quite a bit. I mean, so I can't go into too much detail. What? No, I mean, people, there's like, you know, Gavin has even said, like, hey, there's, you know, if you're gonna, you're gonna rely on an external data feed, right? Because if you wanna know, if you wanna have like financial derivatives based on the price of oil, well, the price of oil has to get onto the network somehow, and you have to trust that. And so if you're trusting that, like, maybe they can do a bit more. So there's a bunch of things you can do, like with, you know, like reality keeps. Yeah, malleability screws it up because a lot of these things are involve multi-sig.
Okay, so question: can we go
larger? Yeah, you can go
larger.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
What else?
You could potentially hedge the price of Bitcoin.
Oh, cool! What would that look like?
I probably can't go into too much detail. Hedgy is doing stuff.
Oh, so how would you do Hedgy then? Give us an example.
I don't know how Hedgy works. What does Hedgy do? Hedgy just has like two or three multisig.
It's a forward contract, right?
Yeah. So, well, right, Hedgy just has two or three multisig. Yep. Anytime you're doing two or three multisig, you want to know that your refunds are going to work. I don't know. don't know the details of how hedging
works. Juan, where's Juan?
Juan?
What? Juan?
Yeah. Tough guy.
I mean, in things like 2 of 3 multisig, malleability is an issue, right?
It's an issue for us.
Yeah, and then, okay, there are workarounds. So, like, I wrote a utility, like, I don't know if this will ever get in there. I have a utility, I guess, like, open source, and people can run it, where it's like a TXID generator and disseminator. So, like, Alice signs her half, Bob signs his half. They each send their half to a trusted third party, which is, like, bad, but hey. And then the trusted third party generates, puts the two together, calculates TXID, tells the TXID to Alice and Bob, and then waits for Alice and Bob to both say, okay, we're ready. You know, we've signed our refunds and stuff. Now broadcast. So that's like a really ugly workaround where you need a trusted third party to hold on to your transaction and not change it. But so far, that's what I'm using. But there's a, you know, if you have, if you fix this, you don't need to do that. And you can potentially do, lotteries, I don't know.
So outside data could be put in if malleability exists?
What good?
You're saying outside data could be put
into Bitcoin? No, the outside data can be put in today. It's the fundamental thing is you want to use multisig between mutually untrusted parties. And a lot of that is on refunds. So like Alice and Bob don't like each other. Otherwise they wouldn't be involved in the lottery. Otherwise then you just shake hands and like do it, you don't need Bitcoin if they trust each other. So Alice and Bob don't like each other, don't trust each other, but both want to sort of have access to the money together, right? And then the data comes in and decides where that money goes. So you need to be able to have, refunds to both of them. So like I put in a Bitcoin, you put in a Bitcoin, we know that if one of us disappears, well, the Bitcoins come back out after a month through a long time or something. And malleability can really screw that up. Because you get hostage situations. I didn't go into it in too much detail, but the, like, Bob saying, hey, sorry, Alice, how about you get half? There's actually, what was it called? The, like, two-part, what was that thing? Bit markets, yeah. And it's totally broken, right? Because this is sort of a tangent, but there's a bunch of people saying, hey, with multisig, we can sort of have like two-party escrow or something. Where like, what was their idea? Their idea was the seller, okay, I sell you a chair for a Bitcoin.
Buyer pays double.
Yeah, the buyer pays double, the seller pays single. And it doesn't work at all because whoever has a lower time value of money, right? So like, let's say you're buying a chair for me, and the chair is one Bitcoin. So I put a Bitcoin into the multisig address, you put 2 in, then I send you the chair, and then I get mine back, and you get 1 of yours back. Or I get 2 out, and you get 1 out. It doesn't work, because what I'll actually do as the chair seller is I'll put a Bitcoin in, you put 2 in, and then I'll just say, okay, I'm getting your money. And there's no chair, and there never was. And here is a bunch of n-lock time transactions. If you want your money back today, I get 2.8. of the Bitcoin, and you get 0.2. Here's the signature for that. If you want your money back tomorrow, you get 2.7. How about next week? You get 2.5. Next week, I basically lower until, if you wait 2 years, you get all your money back.
But you're not getting your deposit.
I don't care. My time value, I'm rich. For me, a Bitcoin is worth much less than 3. Right? I'm rich, so like I can wait a year. It's basically, essentially becomes an interest rate. Where whoever has a lower time value of money can extort more from the other guy. And the guy who's really hurting is like, no, I need that Bitcoin like next week, I gotta pay my rent. He's gonna take the loss. So that's the thing, the implied idea behind those things is that a Bitcoin's worth the same to everyone, but it's not. For some people, if I'm like, one of the early adopters and I have like 10,000 Bitcoin, I want more Bitcoin, but I'm willing to freeze my assets for potentially months and years in order to get one. Whereas most people can't. So malleability, like the sort of hostage situation is a real problem where you think like, wait, if the refunds are broken, both parties can't get their money out. But hostage situations are very dangerous and essentially become like interest rates where whoever wants their money the slowest gets more of it.
Awful things happen to you that you realize?
No, this is security engineering, man. I mean, you've got to like attack every single thing. You got to think of all the attacks before they do. None of these have happened yet, but people are just like, a lot of this is sort of theoretical.
Incentive, so we'll do.
Yeah, if you can make money by ripping people off, you know, you can't, altruism doesn't work, right? You can't assume that all your participants are like, even selfishness doesn't work, right? You don't want to be like, well, they wouldn't do that because they lose money. Yeah, they might. They might be just crazy, right? They might be like, well, I can ruin one of my Bitcoins, but I ruined 2 years, so I'm going to do it. That's still a pretty big threat.
Yep. Can you go back to the check block time verify slide?
Oh, so I didn't talk too much about that. So where was it?
I think you said that it'll solve the malleability problem if you only have one person funding.
Yeah,
right?
For one. So what you can do with, because then you, how do you run it? You have like two of two multi-sig or one signature and lock time verify. That works as long as only one person's getting a refund. Because you can't specify, so let's say Alice puts a Bitcoin in, Bob doesn't put anything in, but it's now a shared two of two with Alice and Bob. That can have a lock time verify back to Alice. Because, you know, it can be, if Alice is key and the time is next week, then the transaction's valid. The problem is you can't have it to both guys. Both Alice and Bob, because then you could just say, like, if Bob's key and next week, or Alice's key and next week, then it's just a race. Right? You want a transaction that's already signed by both parties that's, hey, this, you know, half of it goes to Alice, half of it goes to Bob. Whereas a script can't specify amounts. Right? A script evaluates it either true or false. So it all goes to whoever grabs it first.
Right, so, it seems like the case that check block time verify solves would be the most common case for a lot of applications.
That's true.
I'm wondering what, do you have any examples of interesting things that could be solved that are not solved by the check?
Yeah, so, okay, so yeah, in the case where there's a payment channel which one party funds, and it's generally like incremental payments from A to B, then lock time verify does fix it. You can have sort of full duplex payment channels, where Alice and Bob know they're going to be in a business situation with each other. Like, they're both businesses. Let's say it's Circle and
swap.
What?
A swap?
Yeah, something like that. Or, you know, Circle and Coinbase. They want to trade whatever.
Yeah.
And they want high frequency. They don't have to wait for the blockchain, too. So Circle puts 100 Bitcoins in. Coinbase puts 100 Bitcoins in. And they can actually switch directions by making end lock time come closer. I haven't documented, like, it's a little complicated, but what you do is basically you have your refund, let's say it's next week, and then it starts as A gives more to B, right? So now B's getting 110, B's getting 120, and now B wants to switch and start sending more to A. You bring the lock time closer and then sign that. So, like, if I wait a week, the whole thing is a wash, and I get 100 out, you get 100 out. But now I'm sending you a 6 days from now transaction where you're getting more. And then the guy who wants the reverse direction says, okay, now 5 days from now, you start getting more. So each time you switch direction, you have to move end lock time closer to the present. But you can have sort of bi-directional channels like that. And in that case, both people have money in it, and so end lock time verify won't help for the refund. It's admittedly a more advanced case, and like you could, if all you had was end lock time verify, and you didn't have these sig hash types, you could do it by just making two channels, right? So like I've got a channel from A to B, and I make a channel from B to A, and then I increment and decrement there. So there's, you know, if all you had was lock time verify, you could probably do most of the things you need to get done. But there are a couple of weird cases where like malleability sort of screws up. But yeah, if all, like, I really don't know how Bitcoin's gonna change. It's like, are we ever gonna get over 1 megabyte blocks? I don't know. Are we ever gonna get lockdown verified there? I hope so. All right, and like, if all these things change, great, and we can use it, and we can do really cool stuff. If not, well, there's ways to work around it. So
this 65 hasn't been implemented yet, right?
Wait, six code was written.
This is, it's, I don't know the status of it. What is the status of block time verify?
Yeah, it's been implemented, value a few times.
Well, it's not merged.
No, I mean, it's not merged. It won't be for, I mean, it won't be an open account.
Okay.
How
long do you think before
it gets approved? My guess would be the next release with 562, right alongside.
So a few months or something? Yeah, good. I mean,
it's not tomorrow. Wow.
Yeah, so that's another software. I mean, things do change. We didn't see a whole lot of software stuff in the last year, but like, O10 is cool. It's super fast. So like, it does get better. Like, there's smart people working on Bitcoin today. So, so you want to be conservative in terms of like, hey, I hope we can get all these things through. If we only get this, well, we can work with that. If we can get all these other things, great. Other questions? Good. Okay.
Can you make these slides available?
Yeah, I will put it on the meetup page, like in the comment, and like I'll have the PDF and stuff.
Is this something we can work on Sunday?
Probably. Yeah. I mean, the code itself is pretty simple, but yeah. I don't know if I'm here this Sunday. I don't know, but yeah, I'll talk to you about it. Coming on Sundays and stuff. Or wait, when Andreas is coming, I haven't met him. I should say hi. I'll come. I don't know the guys. Yeah, so I'll come in some way. Cool. Other questions? Good?